Good morning, and welcome to First Presbyterian Church and to our 11:15 worship service. If you are a guest joining us this morning, either in person or online, we want to extend an especially warm word of welcome to you. I am one of the pastors, Josh Squires, and we'll have other pastors around. If you would like to come and talk to us and learn more about us, we would love to come and talk to you. There's also at the end of your pew a friendship register. If you would take that out and fill it out and pass it down. If you would like more information about us, that's a great way to get more information about us. And if you have any prayer requests, you can put your prayer requests in that friendship register and know that we have a group that prays every Monday for the prayers there. Now, I have a number of announcements for us this morning. We are grieving with a number of our families from this past week. First, we are grieving with Mark and Beth Baxa and the family on the death of his father, Ernest Granville Baxa Jr., who died on Wednesday, August the 31st. We're also grieving with Steve and Priscilla Johnson on the death of his father, Dr. David L. Johnson, who died on Monday, September 5th. We're also grieving with Jean and Joan Fulton on the death of his mother, Jane Fulton, who died on Wednesday, September 7th. And finally, we're also grieving with Mary Ann and Mike Rudy on the death of her father, Ed Walker, who also died on Wednesday, September 7th. We are grieving with these, our fellow family members, if you can remember them in your prayers. A couple more announcements. One, we will have a congregational meeting following our worship services next week. That meeting will be called so that we can elect officers. We can hear the report from the church officer nominating committee and any other business that might come up. And then secondly, we have Thanksgiving for Missions. So all ladies are invited to the annual Thanksgiving for Missions dinner and program hosted by the women of the church on Tuesday, September 20th. Jillian Bricky, World Witness Missionary, will be speaking and an offering for missionaries will be collected. Please register by September 16th on the church app or website. So ladies, if you plan on attending, please register this week. That is all for the announcements. Let's now take a moment to prepare our hearts and minds for the worship of God.
Thank you.
Now hear our call to worship, which comes from Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Let us sing a joyful noise to the Lord as we sing hymn 660, O God Beyond All Praising. Heavenly Father, the one who is beyond all praising, yet we do this morning come and praise you that you are God, who is merciful and kind, loving and gentle, one who makes a way that we, even us, those who are sinful and fallen, can come into your courts with praise. And that way is through our Lord and Savior, your Son, Jesus Christ, who took to himself our sinfulness and gave to us his righteousness. And so it's because of that and that alone that we would lift our voices to you and beseech you that you would send your Holy Spirit. That as we worship you this day in prayer and song, the hearing of the word and sacrament, that we would do it rightly in spirit and in truth. And that it would have its effect on our hearts and be lived out by our hands. That you and you alone would get all the glory and honor for our lives. We pray this in the precious name of the one who taught us all to pray, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Christian, what is it that you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us now continue in our worship as we present to the Lord our morning tithes and offerings.
Thank you. Gracious God and most holy heavenly Father, we do praise you, for you're worthy of our praise. And we're so thankful that we have the opportunity now to hear from your word. And so we ask that you would speak to us this morning, that your word would be useful to teach us and reprove us and correct us and train us in righteousness, that we, your people, might be thoroughly furnished unto every good work. And so send forth your spirit and lead us now, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. Our text this morning is Psalm 46, and as you turn there, you might notice that our worship this morning is ordered in some sense around the anniversary of that day 21 years ago of 9/11. And this text was one that rang forth from many pulpits in the days and weeks following that moment. Many of us gathered together at our churches around the nation to be comforted. This text has comforted God's people for millennia, and would it comfort us this morning and whatever we're walking through? Let's give attention to God's word, Psalm 46. To the choir master of the sons of Korah, according to Alamoth, a psalm. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Thanks be to God for his holy, inerrant, and therefore authoritative word. Well, perhaps you've read the book, or maybe you've seen the movie Lone Survivor. It's a story about four Navy SEALs, Marcus Luttrell, Michael Murphy, Danny Dietz, and Matthew Axelson, who were sent on a mission, Operation Red Wings, up into the mountains of Afghanistan to capture or kill a Taliban leader up there, who was known for many American killings. And almost upon arrival, they come upon a conflict. Goat herders had wandered upon their position, and they're left with a dilemma. What do we do with these goat herders? Do we just kill them, although the rules of engagement and our integrity wouldn't necessarily allow that? Do we tie them up and leave them here overnight, though they'll probably freeze to death? Or do we send them back down, though they probably know or maybe even are a part of the Taliban leadership? And they decided to send them back down to the village. Within hours, the Taliban had overrun their position and they were in a firefight. At the end of the day, three of those men would lose their lives. They would call for rescue and a Chinook helicopter would come in. It would be shot down by an RPG. 19 Special Forces soldiers would lose their lives that day, the most at that point in history in the U.S. military. And only one man would live, Marcus Luttrell. He had a broken back, he'd fallen off a cliff, he had shrapnel injuries, and he was afraid. He was in a hole and trying to figure out, what do I do? Where do I go? He crawled 7 miles to a water stream, and there he was found by some local villagers who decided, according to their hospitality custom of old, that they would rescue him. They kept him safe for the next week or so while the Taliban stalked him all over their village, and finally, American troops came in and rescued him. But as you read the book, you get a sense of the panic, the fear that he was experiencing, in part during the fight itself, but mostly in the aftermath as he waited and wondered what would happen in the midst of this chaos. We may not ever experience that sort of extreme level of fear, but we know what fear feels like, don't we? The fear of failure in our work or in our roles, the fear of a bad diagnosis, the fear of losing a loved one, the fear of natural disaster or national chaos. There are many things to be afraid of. In fact, the psalmist says there are a plethora of things to be afraid of. But in the midst of our fear, the psalmist offers us a refuge. And that's what I want us to see this morning. I want us to see that the Lord of hosts is our refuge in moments of fear. There are 3 points in this passage I want to point out. First, God is a refuge in natural disaster. God is a refuge in natural disaster here in verses 1 to 3. The scene is picturesque. The earth is giving way. Perhaps it's an earthquake. The mountains are falling into the heart of the sea, some sort of landslide perhaps. The mountains are tottering and shaking, perhaps a volcano. The waters are roaring and foaming, a hurricane or a tsunami of some sort. There's unnatural things happening in nature. And when that happens, it can alarm us a bit. Maybe you remember this summer when we had some earthquake tremors from miles away, and they didn't really cause any damage, but when we felt them, and when we heard the rumble that we didn't know came with an earthquake, we were alarmed. Or maybe you've experienced something way more intense than that. Maybe it's the flood of 2015, or maybe it's a hurricane on the coast. When things that are supposed to be stable, like mountains, totter, it gives us reason for panic. This psalm points to fear, verse 2, that there's reason for fear. Verse 1, that there's a need for a refuge in the midst of such times. On August 29th of 2005, Hurricane Katrina struck the Mississippi and Louisiana Gulf Coast. And that December of 2005, I had the opportunity to take some college students with a ministry I worked with down to Biloxi, Mississippi. And then that next spring break, we took some people down to New Orleans to do some relief work. And when we arrived at Biloxi, it was astonishing. As we walked along the coast where multi-million dollar homes stood proudly, there was absolutely nothing. There was no remembrance of the fact that those homes were even there. Every now and then you'd find a stray pole that the wind cut around and didn't knock down. And as we arrived in New Orleans, where the levees broke and the city was flooded, there were homes that had just been washed away completely. There were homes that were still there, but they were destroyed and they were molded, and it looked like a war zone. Hundreds of thousands of people were displaced, $180 billion of damages, and 1,833 people lost their lives in those storms. There's real reason to be afraid when nature does what's unnatural. And we often find ourselves asking, but Lord, where are you in the midst of this? Where are you? Where can I turn for help? Why should I not fear? And the psalmist actually says, the Lord is very present. He's not just present, he's very present in times of trouble. In fact, we can interpret, he's well proven to be present in times of trouble in our lives. He says that we have reason to be afraid, but he's near. Perhaps you've experienced that fear. He doesn't say that we won't face hardship. The whole psalm is about hardship. He doesn't say that we won't experience pain. He doesn't even say that we might not lose our lives in the midst of the chaos, but he says in the midst of all of it, you have reason to not be afraid because God is a refuge and he is a strength to you. He is your security. He is your safety. He is your stronghold. As Nehemiah says, the joy of the Lord is your strength, even in the midst of chaos. Nothing can harm us that doesn't first pass through his all-knowing, all-wise, ever-present, holy hands. Those hands even that have been scarred by the cross for his people. It's not the stability of the earth that comforts and protects us. It's our God who is a refuge. And so I wonder, where have you run to for security? Where do you go for stability in your life? Is it your work? Is it your spouse? Is it the success of your kids? Is it money? Is it drink? Is it pleasure, comfort, control, approval, significance? And have any of them ever come through on their promise of refuge for you? Have they ever lasted the night? No, they're all fleeting. None of them actually satisfy us. None of them actually protect us from the dangers of this world. God is our refuge in natural disaster. But secondly, he's a fortress in national disaster. God is a fortress in national disaster here in verses 4 to 7. Look at verse 6. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. It's a picture here of what we would have read in Psalm 2, one of those foundational psalms, Psalms 1 and 2, of the nations, the kings of the earth, plotting against God and against his anointed, and God has enthroned his anointed in Zion, and he sits above and he laughs. North Korean nuclear threats, Russian threats, Chinese threats, Russian invasion of Ukraine that has caused crisis across the globe, terrorist threats in the Middle East and Afghanistan and all around the globe. These things terrify us. And depending on what news media outlet you read, our world, our country specifically, is headed towards civil war and total collapse. And they're coming for you. I don't always know who they are, what they're coming for, how they're going to get it. But I know that as I read and listen and watch, I experience panic. Did you experience that? Panic. Fear in the midst of national disaster. For Israel, there was very real reason to panic. There's a good chance that this psalm reflects a real moment in Israel's history when Sennacherib and his armies, the king of Assyria, overrun Judah. And they're surrounding Jerusalem with 185,000 soldiers. And Jerusalem virtually has no hope. The city of God virtually has no hope. And Sennacherib sends his messengers to add insult to injury in 2 Kings 18. And they proclaim, "Do not listen to King Hezekiah when he misleads you by saying, 'The Lord will deliver us.' Has any of the gods of the nations ever delivered this land out of the hand of the king of Assyria? Who among all the gods of the lands has delivered their lands out of my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem out of my hand?" They have a reason to be terrified. They were outmatched. They were outnumbered. They were threatened. International and national disaster has come to their doorsteps. But King Hezekiah seeks the Lord. And the Lord answers him in his prayer and says, "I will defend this city to save it for my own sake and for the sake of my servant David. I have made a covenant with this people. I will be their God and they will be my people forever, and I will be with you in the midst of this challenge that you're facing." And so the folks in Jerusalem woke up the next morning, if they slept at all, you know, those nights where you don't sleep because of anxiety, or maybe they fasted and prayed and they went out and looked, and sure enough, 185,000 Assyrian bodies were laying out among the landscape. They were done. They were wiped up. And perhaps they remembered that great verse, Psalm 30, verse 5. "Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes in the morning," because the Lord had delivered them, just as he promised. And here, the sons of Korah, who are inspired by the Holy Spirit, declare in verse 4, "There's a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns." There's a wordplay going on in this text. And in verse 2, you see that the mountains are moved into the heart of the sea. They literally topple, or they totter into the sea. In verse 6, the kingdoms totter. They literally topple. But here in the midst of verses 4 and 5, the city of God will never be moved. It cannot totter. It cannot topple, because the Lord is in the midst of her. It's the city of God where God dwells. It's the church today where God dwells with his people. Jesus says, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against her." It will not totter. It will not topple. Natural disaster may give God's people reason for fear. National disaster may give God's people reason for panic. The armies of the nations may terrify us, but the Lord of hosts, literally the Lord of armies, is with us. Do you remember that moment when Jesus was betrayed in the garden, and Judas and his cronies come out to arrest him, and he says the word "I am," and they all fall on their faces? And then Peter pulls out his sword and slices off a soldier's ear. He was an incredible swordsman. He was a fisherman. And Jesus turns and says to Peter, rebukes him and says, "Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father? And he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels." And for those keeping count, that's 72,000 angels by his side when the nations surround us. When two towers fall and 3,000 people tragically lose their lives and the world seems to change forever, the psalmist says, we actually have reason not to fear because the Lord of armies is on our side. The Lord of hosts is with us. He is a fortress. He is a stronghold. He is the high point for us where we can run and be protected. And he is a river to us. It's interesting here because Jerusalem doesn't really have a natural water source. It doesn't have a river that actually flows through the city. The picture here is that God will be her provider. And even if Sennacherib and his armies surround Jerusalem, even if they siege Jerusalem and cut off their food and water, God will be a provider for his people. He is a river of life to them. He is a provider. He is a protector to his people. Why? Because he's the Lord. He's Yahweh. He's the covenant maker, the covenant keeper to us. He's the one who's made covenant even with Jacob, who is a deceiver, who is twisted. By God's grace, he made covenant with him, just like he's made covenant with his people today, through the blood of Christ Jesus on our behalf. There's a refuge in natural disaster. God is a fortress in national disaster. And thirdly and finally, God is the one who screams. God is the one who screams in verses 8 to 11. One day, the earth as we know it will be no more. God will bring forth the new heavens and the new earth, and the earth will not war anymore with man and woman, and man and woman won't war with one another. God will see to it that wars cease. He seems here to have shifted his focus from speaking to Israel at this point to now speaking to the nations. And Del Ralph Davis, who filled this pulpit for many years in the evenings, really blessed us in that way. Once preached on this passage, and I remember him giving this illustration of verse 10, "Be still and know that I am God." And he said, you know, when you think of this verse, you often think of being in a cabin in Vermont, and the snow is falling down, and it's beautiful outside, and it's cold, and it's peaceful and quiet, and you're sitting by a warm fireplace, and you have coffee in your hand, and you're reading God's word, and you're enjoying the Lord, and on the back of that coffee mug, it says, "Be still and know that I am God." It's such a peaceful, beautiful, serene moment. The problem is, that's not the sense of this passage at all. In the midst of this passage, there's raging from the nations, and God is trying to get their attention and forcibly disarm them in the midst of their raging. It's not peaceful. He's booming from heaven. It's a little bit like Little League baseball. Everything's a little bit like Little League baseball. The scene is that the hitter's just gotten walked. The next batter was supposed to be in the on-deck circle. He did not appear there. Now he's supposed to be in the batter's box. He has yet to surface. The umpire's yelling at the coach, the third base coach, "Where's the kid? Get him up here. What's going on?" The players are losing focus. They're digging for dandelions in the outfield. Parents are frustrated. What's going on? Where's this kid? And I, as the coach, look over in the dugout, and I see that he's slapping and tickling with all the other kids. And I don't walk into the dugout and say, "Buddy, it's time to go hit. You're going to do great. Did you hear me? Come on, bud." No, I yell from the field, "Stop it, boys. Be still." Or as the context here says, "Freeze. Relent. Collapse." The earth is filled with natural chaos and national chaos. And God booms from heaven, gets our attention and says, "I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." Maybe it reminds you of our header verse this morning in Philippians 2, where Jesus has come down in his humiliation from heaven, who's born as a man, who's born under the law. He suffered under the miseries of this world. He went all the way to the cross for us. He's been presented in humiliation, but one day the Father will lift him up in exaltation because of his glorious, perfect work for us. And Paul says, therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. There's the name. That Jesus is Lord. He's the covenant maker. He's the covenant keeper. He is God himself, to the glory of God the Father. And so here's the deal. That until we fear the Lord God more than we bow down to natural disaster and national disaster, more than we fear the chaos that might come into our lives, until we are willing to relinquish the control of our lives that we think we have, until we surrender the control that our idols have in our lives and bow down to the Lord God alone, we actually will not have a refuge in him. If you don't know Christ this morning, you do not have a refuge. You have every reason to be afraid in this world and in the world to come. You have no fortress. You have no strong tower. You have no refuge. You have no hope. But the beauty of the gospel is that Christ Jesus can be that refuge to you if you will repent and relent and believe upon him for salvation. And for those who are in Christ Jesus, when we fear him, what we're saying is he is more awesome. He is more holy. He is more powerful than anything in this universe. And an earthquake or a hurricane or another world war have nothing on him, because he reigns and he rules over all of it. And one day he will declare, stop it. And he will be glorified forever. And we will be with him in glory. That's the hope that comes from this passage. And when we see this, nothing can touch us in a sense. We have a refuge. We have a stronghold. We have a fortress. We have a Lord of armies. We know our days are numbered by a good and loving God. And for those of us who are in Christ Jesus, our worst case scenario is future glory. Our worst case scenario is future glory. That's the hope that we have in Christ Jesus. And we will dwell with him in peace in an eternal city that will never totter, that will never topple. Well, let's go to him in prayer. Gracious God and most holy Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are to us a refuge, a fortress, and the one who rules over the nations. We surrender our lives to you in worship this morning. In Christ's name, amen. Well, we'll continue our worship this morning, and we're going to sing A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. This was Luther's song that he wrote from Psalm 46, and it gave him such refuge in hard times in his own life. He would often turn to his friend Philip Melanchthon and say, come, Philip, let's sing the 46th. And so let's stand and sing, and then we'll go to the table. A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, hymn 92. as we come to the table, let us hear the words of institution as found in 1 Corinthians 11. Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" It's such a privilege to come together before this table. And as we come to the table, we often think of this meal in directional terms. It's a meal that causes us to look back upon the Lord Jesus as his body was broken and his blood poured out for us, a sufficient sacrifice. It's a meal that causes us to look forward to the great wedding supper of the Lamb, where we will feast with the Lord forever in eternity. And it's a meal that causes us to look to the present, where we experience our fellowship with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and with one another as the bride of Christ. This meal is a meal that is intimate to us. It's a meal where, by God's grace, he didn't just say, "I want you to hear the gospel just with your ears," but rather, "I want you to be able to taste it and smell it and touch it." It's a meal that is so intimate that Dr. Ferguson used to say, we experience in it the very kiss of God. We taste the gospel. This meal is not one where Jesus is having to be re-sacrificed for our sins. His sacrifice is sufficient once and for all. It's not a meal where his body and blood are in, on, and with, and around the elements. It's not even a meal that's purely symbolic. It's a meal in which God promises that I will be present with you. He is truly, spiritually, really with us in this moment as we sup with him. But this meal is a meal that's for the family of God. It's a family meal. It's a meal for those who have believed upon Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior alone, been baptized, and are fighting sin in their lives. If that's who you are, then this is a meal that wants to reassure you today of the promises of God in Christ Jesus. But if that's not who you are, then this is a meal that we would ask that you let pass by this day, but it would be the last time that it passes by. If you're not a believer in Christ Jesus, if you've not been baptized, if you are holding on to some sort of sin that you're not willing to repent of, then let the elements go and talk to one of us, that today might instead for you be the day of salvation. Run to Christ, believe upon him, and be saved. But for those who are in Christ Jesus, let us feast with joy on the grace of God and the gospel, and let us prepare our hearts.
As we gather around this table of God's covenant love, let's acknowledge the truth of God's righteousness and holiness as he's revealed it through the law, these standards to which we're called that point us to our need of him, our need for his mercy and forgiveness. Let's read God's law as printed in our order of service. God spoke all these words, saying, "I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Honor thy father and thy mother. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Thou shalt not covet." Jesus said unto him, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and prophets. With the assurance of pardon, the forgiveness of our sins, as we look to and trust in our Savior Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul, reflecting on God's law and the righteous fulfillment of that law through Jesus, writes in Romans chapter 8, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us." Let's pray together. Our great and our glorious God, we praise you that you are a God who is with us. We've heard this from your word, where you have promised that you are with us. We know it through our Savior, who is Emmanuel, God with us. And even as we gather around this table, we know that you are great God, are present. We pray that we might look to you in faith, that we might feed upon you by faith, and that we might be spiritually lifted up into your presence. We know that these elements of bread and of wine remain unchanged, but we know that as we feed upon you, we are renewed and changed and strengthened and enjoy communion and fellowship with you. So enable us to know your love, your great work in the past, the marvelous destiny that is ours to feast with you forever in glory, and your presence with us now. This we pray in Jesus' name and for his great sake. Amen. On the night when our Savior Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. He prayed to the Father that it might be blessed. And then he broke it, saying, "This bread, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me."
Gracious God and most holy Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for the gospel. We thank you that you chose to set your affection upon us in eternity past, not because of anything you foresaw within us, but by grace alone. We thank you that you did covenant with your Son and the Spirit to send the Son, that he would go on mission to destroy the works of the devil, to glorify your name, and to ransom for himself a bride. And he would walk into the slave market, so to speak, and he would offer his own blood as the price to rescue us from slavery to sin and Satan and the fear of death. And your Spirit would sustain him in his earthly ministry and regenerate our hearts, and even now begin a process that you will complete at the day of Christ Jesus of sanctifying us, so that we would look more and more like Christ. Not only so, but you have brought us out of the orphanage and you have put us in a family where you are our Father. Christ is our elder brother, and we have brothers and sisters and mothers and fathers and sons and daughters in the faith in our church body. And Father, we recognize that within this church body there are many who are hurting even now. Lord, maybe that's from a bad diagnosis, maybe it's the loss of a loved one, maybe it's a struggle with sin, and we ask that you would be near to them. Your word promises that you're near to the brokenhearted. Would that be true this morning for those in our midst who are hurting? Would you help them? Would you strengthen them? Would you comfort them? Would you give them peace that surpasses understanding? Would you help them? Would you lift their eyes above the clouds to see that just above the sun is shining? And Christ one day will return for us. Father, thank you for the reminder of forgiveness of sins and hope of eternal life. Lord, on this day that we remember those who gave their lives 21 years ago. And we ask your blessing and your nearness in a very real way for those who are continuing to experience the grief of that loss that's so profound to us. And Lord, for those who were willing to put themselves in harm's way to defend this country and to root out evil across the globe, would you bless them for their labor? Would you especially be near to those who lost loved ones in that fight? This day, comfort them with your presence. And Lord, we ask for this country. We pray for our president and our elected officials, our governor, our mayor, and others, Lord, that you would return to this country a sense of civility. Give our leaders wisdom to lead wisely and in a godly manner. We do pray for peace in this land. We pray for peace in this world, and that the kings of the earth would not have their way, but that you would set them down if they rebel against you. But most of all, Lord, we thank you for the promise we know will be fulfilled, that is, that your gospel will go forth to the ends of the earth, and around your throne one day there will be representatives from every tongue, tribe, nation, and people group, and you will be exalted among the nations. You will be exalted in the earth. And so, Father, make us glad and willing participants in that endeavor. Find us faithful, Lord, we pray. And in all of it, Lord, we pray that you would lift yourself up and bring glory and honor and praise as we go forth from this place, that we would go forth with hearts of gratitude that glorify you until the day when you return and bring all praise to yourself. We pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Well, it's always been a tradition of the church that after the supper we sing a hymn of thanksgiving. And our hymn this morning is on the last page of our bulletin. We give thee thanks, O Lord.
Oh,
Now lift your hearts and receive the Lord's benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.